Good morning again. We'd like to welcome you to today's presentation entitled God's Special Gift for a Special People. God's Special Gift for a Special People. You know, I think that everyone at heart likes to get a gift. I've not met anyone who really didn't enjoy getting a gift if they felt like that the person giving it wasn't burdened to give it to them. We like tokens and shows of appreciation that other people care for us. And I appreciate getting good gifts, too. And I remember some gifts that I've gotten through the years that have left an impression upon me. When I was 16 years old, I had a younger friend. His name was Jeff. Jeff and I rode motorcycles some together. And Jeff got me a new wallet for my birthday. And it's not this wallet. That's my current wallet, which was also a gift from someone who cared and appreciated, which I appreciate very much. But when I was 16 years old, I got a very nice quality wallet. And I remember that wallet still. I remember what it looked like, and I remember using it for several years before it finally just wore out. It was made of good top-grade cowhide and lasted me a long time, and I really liked it a lot. As I said, my friend Jeff gave me that, and Jeff today is a very sick man. He has cirrhosis of the liver. He's never been an alcoholic, never drank, but he's just one of those rare people that develops cirrhosis, and he has some other serious problems, so I'd like you to remember Jeff in your prayers. Maybe you remember a special gift that's been important to you down through the years. After my father died, my mother gave me a very valuable gift, very, very important to me. She gave me my dad's United States Navy flight jacket. And if you look closely on the part of the, near the zipper area, you see that it's been perforated with USN, United States Navy. This is not a replica. This is not a look-alike. This is the genuine real McCoy. It's one of the most valuable items I have, and it's one of the most important things that I have emotionally that's been ever given to me. But, beloved, the greatest gift that was ever given is the gift of God's dear Son. In John chapter 3, verse 16, I think we all know the verse, it says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And it says here that God so loved the world that he did something. He gave. And the Greek word for gave, as we look in our slide here, is didomi. And it means a gift, something given. And the first place that a gift is mentioned in the Bible is in Genesis 25 and verse 6. So let's turn to Genesis chapter 25 and verse 6. Remember Abraham, he had been married to Sarah. And then after Sarah died, he had another wife. Her name was what? Keturah. And they had some children. But now Abraham has a problem. He wants to leave his inheritance to Isaac, but he still has his other children. He wants to do something for them. So as we look here in verse 6, and it says, unto the sons of the concubines which Abraham had, Abraham gave gifts and sent them away from Isaac his son, while he yet lived eastward in the east country. So he gave them gifts. He wasn't obligated to. His inheritance rightly would go to Isaac, but he gave them gifts. In Numbers chapter 18, Numbers 18 and verse 29, it says, and of all your gifts you shall offer every heave offering of the Lord, of all the best thereof, even the hallowed part thereof out of it. As the children of Israel would come to the sanctuary, they would bring their sin offerings, they would bring their burnt offerings, but they would bring gifts. They would bring thank offerings. And things that just simply showed their appreciation. They were trying to give back something to God because of all that he had given them. Now, we're going to come back to gifts in just a little bit, but I want to change directions for just a little bit. When God led these children of Israel, that we're reading about here in Numbers, when he led them out of the land of Egypt, did you know that he did this in a very special way? That God had a special, unique channel through which he worked to lead them out of the land of Egypt. That's right. If we turn back to the Old Testament book of Hosea, Hosea chapter 12 and verse 13. It says, and by a prophet the Lord brought Israel out of Egypt, and by a prophet was Israel preserved. Now notice there's two very important aspects here. That God, first of all, brought them, he delivered them. One might say he justified them out of Israel or out of Egypt. But then he preserved them, he sanctified them through the prophet as well. In other words, the prophet, using a prophet, had a very important aspect of their coming up out of Egypt. And this prophet, we know specifically, wasn't just anyone, it was Moses. It was Moses. And God used Moses in a very significant manner. And there is a connection, there is a parallel here between God bringing the children of Israel out of Egypt and what he's going to do for his remnant people. Turn with me to the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 11, verse 16, please. And there shall be an highway for the remnant of his people, which shall be left from Assyria, like as it was to Israel in the day that he came up out of the land of Egypt. Now, how was it when Israel came out of the land of Egypt? How did they come out? Remember, Hosea said they came out by a prophet. And it says that there's going to be a remnant of God's people. Now, I know that in the Old Testament there was a remnant type of people. But God in these last days, beloved, has a special remnant people, doesn't he? He has a special people, friends, and he's done something very special for those people to help them. That's right, absolutely. And I just want to say this today, that if you're not a part of that remnant people today, you should be. And you can be. And God wants you to be. And may I say humbly that we need to know who we are as a people. Because we're not just anyone, friends. We're not worldly people. We're not part of the riffraff of the world. And we're not part of the confusion that God calls Babylon in his word. In 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9. Here we find a description of what God's people are supposed to be like. It says, "But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, a peculiar people, and that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of what? Darkness into his marvelous light." Friends, we should know who we are. We're not just anyone. We are God's special people. And we have a special work to do. But God knows, friends, just like any person going to any job, a carpenter needs his hammer, he needs his saw, he needs his level, he needs his square. The plumber needs his wrenches, his soldering torch. And friends, we need tools. And God has seen fit to give his people tools. But we have been especially called to be a people, friends, according to Revelation chapter 14, 12, who will keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Do you believe that? Can you say amen to that? Now, I want to tell you that faith is important. The Bible speaks about the faith of Jesus. But Jesus didn't say, "Blessed are they that believe." He said, "Blessed are they that do his commandments," Revelation 22, 14, "that they may have right to enter into the eat the tree of life and enter into the gates within the city." Jesus didn't say that the blessing was simply for believing. The blessing is for those who are faithful. And in Matthew chapter 25, in verse 21, Jesus in the parable speaks unto the servant, and he says, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord." Now, was he commending this servant for doing something or believing something? He commended him for doing something, for taking the thing that had been entrusted to him and doing something with it. Now, it's interesting, it uses the word faithful. And this is based upon the same word in the Greek that we get our word faith for. Goes back to the same root concept. And so to be faithful, you have to have faith. But friends, if you're really faithful, you're going to do something with it. Because faith works by love and purifies the soul. Galatians chapter 5 and verse 6. And verse 23 also. "And he said unto him, Well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord." Again, Jesus commended the servants for having enough faith to do something. They have faith that works. And friends, that's not legalism. That's love. That's love, that we love God so much that we would rather die than break his commandments. Jesus did not say, "If you love me, honk your horn." Have you ever seen bumper stickers? Yeah. "If you love me, if you love Jesus, honk your horn." Jesus said, "If you love me, keep my commandments." Mm-hmm. And friends, today there is a movement abroad to try to devalue the commandments of God, to devalue anyone who would see a burden and a need in obeying those commandments and keeping those commandments, and it's called legalism. It's called legalism. But friends, if the motive is the right motive, it's simply love.
That's right.
It's love. And Jesus said, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments." Now back in our text in Isaiah, God says he will provide a highway for his remnant people, such as they had when they came up out of the land of Egypt. And again, how did he bring them out of the land of Egypt? He brought them through a prophet. through a prophet. And God gave the gift of prophecy to help direct and to sustain, to bring them out and to preserve Israel as a people. The children of Israel were under a physical bondage, beloved. But the remnant people in the last day have been held in a spiritual bondage to spiritual Egypt today. And God wants to bring them out of that spiritual bondage. And He not only wants to bring them out, but He wants to preserve them. And He's going to have a remnant. He's going to do it just like He did it with the children of Israel out of Egypt. And how did He do it with the children of Israel out of Egypt? He did it through a prophet. That's right. Friends, the remnant people of God will not simply profess to keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. No, no. They will be a faithful, believing people. And Isaiah tells us that God is especially going to be using the gift of prophecy in doing this work. And in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 17, the Bible says, the dragon was wroth with the woman. Now, who is the dragon?
Satan.
And who is the woman?
Church.
Represents the church, God's church. And went to make war with the remnant of her seed. That's the very last part of His church. And what are the characteristics of this woman? It says, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. But Revelation chapter 19, verse 10 says, worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. It is the spirit of prophecy. This is what the testimony of Jesus is. It is the spirit of prophecy. Now let's just take a minute. Let's go back to where we began at the beginning. And let's talk about gifts for a minute. Can we do that? Did you know that the gift of prophecy is just spoken of exactly like that in the Bible? It's called a gift. It's something that we haven't earned. It's something we don't deserve. But something that God in His goodness and out of His love has graciously given to His people. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8, wherefore He saith, when He ascended up on high, He led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. After Jesus ascended to heaven, the Bible says He sent special gifts through His Holy Spirit. And in verse 11, Paul begins to enumerate what some of these gifts are. And notice what they are in verse 11. And He gave some apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. And it says He gave them these gifts. And it's interesting that the Greek word that's translated gave in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 8 is the same word that we saw didomi in John 3:16. God so loved the world that He gave. But it's what's also interesting is that this word gift is the Greek word doma. And that word doma comes from didomi. What He is saying is He gave something that He gave. Of course, that's what a gift is. It's something you give. You give a gift. A gift is something you give. These two words, basically from the same root, compounded together. It's an emphasis, friends. He gave gifts unto us. And those gifts are also enumerated in some of those gifts in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and 1 Corinthians chapter 14. And they deal with spiritual gifts. But now the question I want to ask you today is, why did God give these gifts? What was so important about these? Well, notice the gifts again in verse 11. And He gave some what? Apostles. Now, what does the word some mean? Does it mean everyone? It doesn't mean no one, but it means some. It means a part. Not everyone was called to be an apostle, friends. But some have been called. Some are evangelists. Not all, but some. Some are pastors, some are teachers. And some are prophets. Not all. But God has set very specific gifts in His church for a reason. And in verses 12 and 13 here, He tells us why. He says, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come into the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God into a perfect man, into the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Friends, don't let anyone tell you that God doesn't want you to be perfect. He says right here that He has given us gifts so that we can become perfect. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 48, Jesus says, be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. And that's pretty perfect, isn't it? We have been told that we can become perfect in our sphere as God is in His. But friends, God's sphere is pretty big. But it's beautifully perfect and holy. And you can keep your hand here in Ephesians, but I want you to turn with me to the book of 1 John. I want you to notice something. We're having a little Bible study Thursday night. We read this Thursday night, and I'd like to read it with you tonight. In 1 John chapter 2. First John chapter 2, verses 28 and 29. He says, "And now, little children, abide in him, that when he shall appear, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. If ye know that he is righteous, ye know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born of him." And we're going to continue in a minute. But we're discussing the ideas, can we really be like Jesus? Does he expect us to be like him? You know, so many people in the world today, you can't be like Jesus. You can't live to that standard. But in verse 1 of chapter 3 now, continue. He says, "Behold, with what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be what? We shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is." Now, friends, am I going to be omnipotent when Jesus comes? No. Will I be omniscient like Jesus is when he comes? I don't know. So what does he mean that we will be like him? If we read on in verse 3, "And every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure." And now verse 4, "Whosoever committeth sin transgresses also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law." Beloved, that's how we're going to be just like Jesus. There's not going to be any sin. We won't be breaking God's law anymore. Don't you tell me for a minute that the concept of keeping the commandments of God is not important, friends. The very basis upon which we will be judged to be like Jesus and worthy to see him is based on the fact that we have ceased to sin as a people. And he's promised to be able to do that. And back in Ephesians 4, he tells us that he's given us gifts to help us in this experience. Until we come into a knowledge of the Son of God. Combined with these gifts, it brings the people, in verse 14, "that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive." He says that he wants to bring us up into a perfect man, and we're going to be so clear in these things, friends, that we won't be carried away with every wind of doctrine. And I'm going to tell you what, friends, there's a lot of winds of doctrine going on today.
Amen.
There are the ideas that we're going to be keeping the feasts. There are the ideas that we measure the Sabbath upon the moon. And all kinds of things, friends, today. And people are starting to get more and more involved in these things. I want to tell you something. There's a direct correlation almost every time between the giving up of the spiritual gifts that God has given to his church and the acceptance of these doctrines. That when we give up on the spiritual gifts, and especially the gift of prophecy, because that's the way God's going to specially lead and help his remnant peoples to the gift of prophecy. When we give up on that gift of the testimony of Jesus, when we start to set it aside, when we start to say, this gift maybe helped me at one point, but I went beyond it, or I find that it has failed me, we'll get into trouble. Now, if there is a last day application book, friends, it's the book of Revelation. Don't you believe that?
Amen.
Now, I'm not a futurist. Don't get me wrong. I don't believe in teaching the book of Revelation from futurism. I believe that we have the historicist method of interpretation that's been sound and solid for the last 500 years. The Protestant Reformation started to interpret the book of Revelation, understood that it was unrolling a scrolled history. If there was a book that we needed to understand the lessons as well as prophecies from, particularly pertaining to us the last days, it is the book of Revelation. And I find it interesting, as I read through the book of Revelation, do you know how many times the book of Revelation mentions the gift of evangelism or being an evangelist? Do you know how many times? Not a single time. Now that doesn't detract from the gift of evangelism. It just simply means that there are no evangelists mentioned in the book of Revelation. It's not an emphasis there. There are zero pastors and zero teachers. Apostles are fleetingly mentioned, but not as having an active role. But the gift of prophecy is over and over mentioned in the book of Revelation, and particularly in connection with the remnant people who keep God's commandments and have the testimony of Jesus, which is the spirit of prophecy. And in this study today is going to focus on the spiritual gift that God has given to his people to study the certainty that we are in the people and that we can keep on track, that we have been a people who have been called out of spiritual Egypt, and we'll be people preserved from spiritual Egypt if we allow God to lead us as he's determined to lead us. Now, I believe, first of all, that God used a specific person to fulfill this prophecy of Revelation 12, 17, and 19:10. And her name was Ellen G. White.
Amen.
And most of you have heard of her. And we'll come back to her in a little bit later. But I believe that he used her in a marked way to set a pathway for his people. But it wasn't because, friends, that the Bible wasn't complete or perfect. Turn with me to the book of 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 15 and 16. It says, "And thou from a child," Paul's writing to his son in the faith, Timothy, his last letter he's ever going to write to him. He better say the most important things. He better not miss it. He says, "And that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness." And in verse 17, "that the man of God may be" what? "Perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works." And so the Bible says, friends, that we can be perfect. And the Bible says itself that within the Word of God there is enough to bring perfection to humanity. And I believe that. The Word of God, in other words, is complete and it is perfect. And everything that we have need of is in the Word of God. And I have to confess to you, though, today, friends, that I am one of the weakest of the weak people on earth. You know, if you're trying to lift a heavy load, and someone comes along to help you, it sort of takes the burden off of you, and you can lift a little easier, can't you? When you're weak, you realize that you need help. I'm not, for many years, been a really strong person. I don't have that big tricep. I'm one of the weakest of the weak, mentally, spiritually. And I just want to say this, that I need all the help that I can get. I need all the help I can get. Now, when Paul wrote the letter to the church at Ephesus, some of the Bible had already been written at that time. There was more Bible to be written. But if the Bible was all that God ever intended to use, now listen to me carefully, the Bible is all that we need, but if it was all he ever intended to use, why would he give us apostles? Why did he give us pastors? Because these are gifts that are being given until the very end of time, until Jesus comes. They're not gifts given just at one period of time. They're all the way till Jesus comes. And he's given us these gifts, friends, for a reason, because they help as we use the Word of God to bring us perfection. That's why I'm standing up in front of you today as a pastor, speaking to you. Because part of the responsibility God has given to me is to expound his Word to you and to edify and to help you this way. And you recognize this, and that's why you're here. And God wants to use these spiritual gifts to bring his people to perfection, to bring them to the place that they're not blown around with every wind of doctrine. Now today, there are some people who do not want pastors. But dear believer, pastors are a part of God's plan. If you don't like pastors, don't complain to me. Talk to God about it. Because here in Ephesians 4, he says that they're part of his plan. You know, some of us have come out of a very oppressive theological system. We might say it was an ecclesiastical system that was oppressive. And we've had pastors that have ruled over us. Pastors that have thrust with side and shoulder, as he says in Ezekiel. It's caused some of us to have a rebellion against authority. Rebellion against God-given authority. To the point we even make light of it at times. But we should never do that. We should be thankful for what God has given. Further, if you don't like the gift of prophecy today, if you don't like the testimony of Jesus today, don't blame me. I mean, if you want to, that's okay. But the fact is, friends, I'm not the problem. And if you don't like the testimony of Jesus, the problem is not the testimony of Jesus. Talk to God about it, because He's the one who gave the testimony of Jesus. When people tell you that a prophet has failed them, they are telling you, or at least beginning to tell you, that they have rejected the gift of prophecy. And in the case of Seventh-day Adventism, this is a rejection of the ministry of Ellen G. White. And with that rejection, there must finally come a rejection of the Advent movement. You can bet on it. You can bank on it. It is sure. Now, we are living in a time, friends, when humanity, as I said earlier, is at its weakest point of existence. And those who will stand the terrible last days, they will need all the help they can get. And it's true, you know, Ellen White made a statement about her writings. It's published in the Review and Herald of January 20, 1903. And she said that her writings were a lesser light to lead men and women to the greater light. And she was referring to the Bible. She says her writings are a light, but she says they're a lesser light to lead us to a greater light. Now, have you ever been down in a cave before? I like caves. I think caves are fascinating, very interesting. One cave I probably will never get to go in, because it's not a public cave, is Luchagia. Have you ever heard of Luchagia? It's down near Carlsbad Caverns in that area, and it may be even actually bigger than Carlsbad Caverns. They're still studying and trying to map this cave out. It's just a pristine, beautiful place. We see a picture of it here in this slide. But you know, it's interesting, as you look at that slide picture, you see the beautiful reflection in the perfectly quiet, cold pool there. You see the different colors and the stalactites and stalagmites and those columns and pillars, and it's just beautiful. But you know, those bonkers who go in there, they don't get to see it like that. They have those little headlights, and they can only see it a little bit at a time. And to make a photograph like this, friends, is a tremendous effort. They have to haul in hundreds of pounds of equipment, big flashlights, too, because this is a huge area. This isn't a little area that your Kodak or your little iPhone can flash and get a picture of. It's a huge area. And they have to haul in these batteries and big floodlights and strobes and get it all wired and set up. And it's a lot of work. And then they, just for a fleeting moment, see it like this. And without those lights, do you know what Luchagia looks like? It looks like our next slide. That's what Luchagia looks like inside. You can't see anything. You can't see your hand right in front of your face. Now, friends, Luchagia is one of the most complex caves in the world that we know of. And if you were down in the bowels of that cave, maybe in the third or fourth level down, passed through 15, 20 corridors, and someone offered you a little flashlight, would you be interested? Maybe you say, no, I don't really like that. I want a big light. Or I want to go out where I can see the light of the sun. I need the big light. I don't want this little light. It doesn't have any use for me. But friends, if that little light will help you to get to the second, the third level, and up to the left quarter, the right quarter, and then finally out to the cave entrance, you'd be pretty thankful for that little light, won't you? Yes. I think so, too. I think so, too. And so even if we have just a little light, I'm thankful for a lesser light, if it helps lead us to the greater light. In many ways, friends, the history of Adventism, and especially the early history of the Adventist people, it has been bound up and it is tied inseparably to the life and the ministry of Ellen White. And when you think of some of the great crisis points in the formation of Adventism and in their early history, we see Ellen White continually playing a critical and a vital role. There's a statement you're pretty well familiar with, I think. It's on page 169 of the book Life Sketches. And in that statement, Ellen White says, "In reviewing our history, having traveled over every step of advance to our present standing, I can say, praise God, as I see what the Lord has wrought, I am filled with astonishment and with confidence in Christ as leader. We have nothing to fear for the future, except as we shall forget the way the Lord has led us and," what? "His teaching in our past history." Life Sketches 196. But do any of us know where this statement originally came from? I'm sorry, I didn't give it to you there. It was in here. Do any of us know where this statement originally came from? I'd like to tell you. It was first published in 1893 in a General Conference Bulletin. Do you remember what was happening in 1893? The last part of the year, in the December issue and the November issue of the Review and Herald, Ellen White had been speaking about the latter rain. And she said the latter rain is being poured out now in the revelation of the righteousness of Christ, the sin-pardoning Redeemer. And it was right at this very time that Ellen White was saying, don't ever say the church is Babylon. Remember those statements? All these statements come at this very time. And so at this very time, she says, I'm looking back and I see that God has been leading us and God is with us and His teachings are true. And these are our teachings. It was first published in 1893 in a General Conference Bulletin just about 50 years from the time that the movement began. The prophet is talking about 50 years of time, not a small sliver of time, but the continual way that God had led and worked in His people. Now, if we go back just a few years, you might recognize this picture. It's a very famous picture in Seventh-day Adventism. Where was it taken? Where? In Minneapolis, Minnesota. That's right. And when was it taken? What was the year?
1888.
1888. We're all familiar with this picture because we've heard so much about this story of 1888. There was quite an aftermath of that conference session, and still perhaps the most discussed event in the history of Adventism today. And there were issues from that conference that resulted in discussions and division. And Ellen White helped to play a very important role to clarify the issues and to give perspective to that conference so that those people, as well as us living today, need not be deceived or discouraged. In 1899 to 1901, there was something happening in the Indiana Conference of Seventh-day Adventism, and it became known as the Holy Flesh Movement. This movement involved the doctrines of the Incarnation and the nature of Christ and sanctification. And this movement also involved a type of Pentecostal worship style. And here again, we find Ellen White played a large role in helping to quench this controversy and to bring the brethren to the point of truth. Have you ever seen a picture of this gentleman, Albion Fox Ballinger? Who was he? Well, he was a very prominent Seventh-day Adventist minister. He was especially well known for being a public evangelist and drawing large crowds with his charismatic style of speaking. And one day he began an in-depth study on the sanctuary. Some of us are studying the sanctuary here in our Sabbath school, aren't they? And he decided that he was going to study the sanctuary because he felt like there was just something wrong. He was watching these Pentecostal people and he saw how they were getting greater crowds than he was and how people seemed to be flocking to those things. And he said, we have a message. If we had the Spirit like they did, there's something wrong. And he began to study and thought, must be the sanctuary message. Something in the way we understand the sanctuary message is wrong. He began to understand it and he came to some very different conclusions. And one of those conclusions was that something happened in 31 A.D. when Jesus went back to heaven at His ascension. Then He went straight to the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary, and that's where He'd been ministering since that time. And that the Day of Atonement, this antitypical Day of Atonement, began not in 1844 at all. And what is of interest that you might find important is that Ballinger put together text after text after text after text to defend his position. In other words, he could give you a long Bible study on it. And it's actually true that very few of our ministers understood from the point of the Bible alone how to deal with Ballinger. There came a man a few years later, his name was Desmond Ford. You remember Desmond Ford? Became popular in the 1970s, especially in 1980. There was quite a schism in the church over Desmond Ford. And a lot of our ministers, they didn't understand from the Bible alone how to deal with Desmond Ford. But friends, we have been given a guiding light of the Spirit of Prophecy who helped us through those crises. And Ellen White acknowledged that Ballinger used many Bible texts, but she could boldly declare this. And this is from manuscript release number 760, page 4. There is not truth in the explanations of Scripture that Elder Ballinger and those associated with him are presenting. The words are right, but misapplied to vindicate what? Error. We must not give countenance to his reasoning. He is not led of God. Our work is to bind up the testimonies God has given and seal the law among his disciples. Can you say amen to that? Friends, that's still our work today.
That's right.
It's still our work today. Ellen White knew that if Ballinger's message was accepted, it would undermine our whole faith. And so she was given a clear, distinct message about this, as we would continue in that same manuscript release. In clear, plain language, I am to say to those in attendance at this conference, and she's making reference to the 1905 General Conference, that Brother Ballinger has been allowing his mind to receive and believe specious error. God has not indicted the message that he is bearing. This message, if accepted, would undermine the pillars of our faith. And so God used the prophet. And as the people took the writings of spirit prophecy and they compared them with the Bible, they could come up to a Bible solution to know how to deal with what Ballinger was teaching. But Ballinger wasn't the biggest fish in the pond. There was a man who came later. His name was Dr. John Harvey Kellogg. And I'd like to just take a minute and I just want to beg to differ with one of my brethren on the prayer request today. The doctors don't always tell us wrong. Dr. Kellogg was one of the best physicians in the world. When he told someone, you do this for that illness, you do this for this situation, if they did it, most of the time they got better. Kellogg was such a good physician. Ellen White said he was the Lord's physician. She said, he's God's physician. Now, he didn't like that title. He didn't. He told her, he said, don't call me that. But she says, you're God's physician. And a good physician, a godly physician, has a place. But I want to tell you something, friends. They're not all called to be prophets, and they're not all called to be apostles, and very few of them are called to be pastors. And Dr. Kellogg wasn't called to be those things. He was called to be the Lord's physician. And when he did that, he did a great job at it. We know that he wrote a book, and that book was entitled The Living Temple. And that book was a good book on physiology, health, hygiene, natural treatments, what to do when you get sick, how to live healthy. It was excellent. It was blue ribbon. It was the best that the world could have offered at that time. But we realize that's not the only issue in the book Living Temple, was it? Those of us who know the history know that Dr. Kellogg decided to mingle certain aspects of his theology with the book Living Temple. And one of those aspects of theology was pantheism, a type of belief in the ever-presence of God in everything. And Dr. Kellogg says that he came to his conclusions based upon accepting the Trinitarian doctrine. He understood the issue of the Holy Spirit better. And yet the doctrine of the Trinity perverted his mind so much that he could not think properly. Now, Ellen White did not sit back as an idle spectator and allow the church to be swept away into spiritualism. But interestingly, Dr. Kellogg quoted from the testimonies. He would quote testimony after testimony, supposedly to substantiate and to prove his point. He hadn't come to the place that he would just say, I'm going to do away with the spirit prophecy, or Ellen White has let me down. He said, oh no, I believe these testimonies. They teach just exactly what I do. That was what he said. And I want you to understand something about Dr. Kellogg, friends. He was a well-loved person in this denomination. He had been a very generous person in this denomination. And he was the head of the Battle Creek Sanitarium. And you'd have to understand something about the Battle Creek Sanitarium at this time, before it burned down. It was the premier health institution in the world. I mean, it was like the Mayo Clinic of today. It was like going to John Hopkins Hospital today. People from royalty from overseas, from Europe, came to attend this great facility. And he employed more people in that facility than was employed by the whole General Conference around the whole world. There was quite a movement to support Kellogg that we don't understand today, friends. Well, it took a meeting of the iceberg head on to deal with this problem. But God, through Ellen White, met that iceberg. And because of her counsel, the church was saved. Now, what I've just told you are just some events that you may remember from history. But in these cases and others, Ellen White played a leading role in dealing with winds of doctrine, in dealing with people who were teaching something different from the history of the first 50 years. God gave this movement, friends, in the beginning, a chart and a compass to enable them to go to the heavenly harbor. But today there are winds of doctrine that are trying to blow us away and back out to sea and to take our chart and our compass away from us. But I believe, friends, that there should be in each one of our minds clarity on all of these major issues. And the spirit of prophecy was given to help us to avoid these pitfalls in all of these areas. And we do not need to fear, friends, as long as we shall remember the way the Lord has led us in our past and his teachings in our past history. If we could turn to 2 Chronicles chapter 20 and verse 20. Judah was facing the opponent. And Jehoshaphat told the people, he says, "Believe in the Lord your God, so shall you be established. Believe his prophets, so shall you prosper." Why did Jehoshaphat say that? Because a prophet had earlier come in and said, the Lord's going to give you a great victory. All you have to do is go out in faith and believe, and God will give you the victory. And Jehoshaphat said, if you believe that prophet, but you know what, friends, they did more than just believe that. What did they do?
They went out
to war. And they got singers, and they said singers in front in the beginning, praising the Lord for the beauty of holiness and for the goodness of God. And God gave them a single victory unlike any other victory Israel ever had or Judah ever had. Believe in the Lord your God, so shall you be established. Believe his prophets, so shall you prosper. Friends, today I believe his prophet. And I want to tell you without any reservation, she's not let me down. She's only encouraged me, she's only helped me, and she has given me a chart and a compass. And today I am thankful that God, as a good giver of gifts, has given us the gift of prophecy, aren't you? The greatest gift is the gift of his Son, and so thankful we should be, so appreciative we should be of that gift. But friends, we have become a people who are just ingrates. We have so much ingratitude. People will give us a gift, we don't even say thank you. People do nice things for us, and we don't show like we care. It reminds me of a picture I saw. These are pigs under the oak tree. It's not a very good picture, but they're eating the acorns. They never look up to see where those acorns come from, do they? They just always look down, just their nose right in the acorns. That's the way we are. Our noses are right down in the blessings, but we don't appreciate the giver. We don't appreciate where they come from. Let us not be ungrateful people, friends. Let us appreciate the gift that God has given to us. Now, at this time, we're going to have a children's story, but you can just stay where you're at. But I saved the children's story for last because I think it applies. But I want to tell you a story about Dr. Christensen. Dr. Christensen was a religious professor, and he taught a required survey of Christianity course at a small college. And in this college, every freshman, regardless of what their degree was going to be in, had to take Dr. Christensen's course. And although he tried hard to communicate the gospel, very few students seemed to appreciate or viewed the class very well. They viewed it simply as a waste of time, just a requirement that they had to have. And so one particular year, Dr. Christensen had a student named Steve. Now, Steve was the center on the football team. He was a big, strong, husky guy. He was also a devoted Christian who loved the Lord. And Steve had planned to go to the seminary when he finished his schooling there. And so Dr. Christensen decided that he would talk to Steve about this matter. And he asked him to stay after class one day. And he asked him just a simple question. He said, "Steve, how many push-ups can you do?" He said, "Well, I do 200 every night, sir." "Do you think you could do 300? "Yes, I think I could do 300, he said. "I've never done them before, but I think I can." "Good," Professor Christensen said. And he proceeded to tell Steve a little plan he had. And so Friday came. Steve came into class early. And the students started to filter in. And then Dr. Christensen came in with a big box filled of beautiful glazed donuts. I don't know about you, but I love glazed donuts. Now, I've quit eating these glazed donuts, mind you. But let's face it, all young college students, they like glazed donuts, don't they? I think so. And so Dr. Christensen, he went up to the first seat, the first girl sitting there, her name was Cynthia. He says, "Cynthia, would you like to have a glazed donut?" "Yes." "Steve, would you do 10 push-ups so that Cynthia can have a glazed donut?" "Sure." He hopped down and he pumped up 10 push-ups like it wasn't anything. And he put the donut down on her desk. So he went down to the next desk. Joe, would you like to have a donut? Yes. Well, Steve, would you do 10 push-ups so that Joe over here can have a donut? Sure. So he did 10 more push-ups. And went all the way down the first row. And then the half of the next row. Until he came to Scott. Now, Scott was on the basketball team. And Scott was sort of a, we'd say, a ladies' man, or so he thought he was. And he was going to do his push-ups. He says, oh, I'll take the donut if I can do my own. Professor said, no, you can't do any. He has to do them for you. He said, well, I don't want a donut then. He says, well, I'm sorry, that's the way it is. You have to have it anyhow here. And he says, that's not fair. And Professor Christian said, look, this is my classroom. These are my desks. This is my class. These are my rules. I can do it any way I want. I'm going to put the donut here. And if you don't want it, you don't have to do anything with it. You leave it here. But Steve, will you do 10 push-ups so that he can have the donut he doesn't want? Yes. So Scott got his donut after Steve did his 10 push-ups, but he wouldn't touch it. And so they moved down the line, and they came to the next desk. Jenny, would you like to have a donut? No. Steve, would you do 10 push-ups so Jenny can have the donut she doesn't want? Yes. And by this time, Steve's starting to get pretty tired. He's done a lot of these push-ups now. And the sweat is starting to come off his face, and he's getting red, and you can see the perspiration through his clothing. But he does 10 more so Jenny can have the donut that she doesn't want. And there were uneaten donuts on just about every desk by now. And he's going back, and he comes back. In fact, he even asked Robert. Robert was the most avowed infidel in the group. The strongest unbeliever. He said, Robert, I want you to watch and make sure he does everyone all the way right. No cheating on these push-ups. He's got to go all the way down. So they made sure he did. Well, after a while, students from other classes came in and started to sit down along the side of the room. When the professor saw them, he counted them, and he realized there were 34 people now in the room. And he was worried about Steve. Thought he could do 300, but can he do this many? And Jason, a recent transfer student, didn't know what was going on. He started to come in, and the students all saw him come in. They said, no, no, go away! Get out of here! But he didn't know better, and he came in. So the professor said, Steve, would you do 10 push-ups so Jason can have a donut? Yes, sir. So he's straining, and he's grunting, and he's quivering. But he does his 10 push-ups. And so now Dr. Christensen, he's at the fourth and the final row. And Steve's arms are shaking uncontrollably with each push-up. And by this time, the sweat is pouring off of his face and arms. And the last two students are cheerleaders. They're girls. Linda, would you like to have a donut? Linda cries, no, thank you. Professor turned to Steve. Steve, would you do 10 push-ups so Linda can have the donut she doesn't want? Yes, sir. And he grunted and he strained through every 10 push-ups. And then he comes to the last girl. Susan, would you like a donut? With tears flowing down her face, said Brother Christensen, can I help? No, you can't help. He has to do them alone. No, I don't want one. Steve, will you do 10 push-ups so that Linda can have the donut she doesn't want? And he did 10 more. And after he'd finished those 350 push-ups, his arms buckled and he collapsed. He fell to the floor. And then Professor Christensen turned to the room and he said, that was our Savior Jesus Christ pleading to the Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. With the understanding that he had done everything that was required of him, he collapsed on the cross and died. And like some of those in the room, many of us leave the gift on the desk. The gift was there. The gift was purchased. But they dare not eat it, they thought. But you know, friends, what about us? A gift has been purchased for us. Kevin, there's a gift that's been purchased for you. And today, you could stand up and confess Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. And you might think, you know, I wish he wouldn't speak to me personally here in a group of people. And maybe Mom wouldn't want me to speak to him. But I'm going to tell you something, Kevin. If someday you're lost in eternity, you will wish I'd said more. And every one of you will wish I'd said more. And Ben, and others that need to make a decision. And Barb and Shaky, if you're out there right now listening on the phone, we need to make a decision that we will not be ungrateful to this gift that God has given in His Son. Because I'm going to tell you what Steve did was paltry. It was nothing compared to Jesus dying on the cross. And yet we can watch a man do push-ups and our hearts can be jerked as we see this big husky guy doing these push-ups. Friends, has the world and have our values been so... Has the world got a hold of our minds and twisted our values so much that we can't appreciate the gift of salvation? The gift of salvation. God's calling you today. He's not calling you tomorrow. He's calling you today. And He's calling a special people, a special remnant people today, friends. And He's calling us and He's giving us a special gift. And what are we going to do with that gift? Are we going to leave it on the desk? Are we going to take those red books, those black books, and go leave them on the shelves? That's what we've been advised to do by someone recently. But friends, it's not for me. That's not where I'm going. It is a lesser light, that's true, friends, but it helps me to understand the greater light so much better, and I'm thankful for it. And you know what? Today we've had a Bible study, haven't we? We've had a Bible study, and I've had that Bible study, friends, because I've understood this Bible better based upon that gift that's specially enumerated in Ephesians 4:11, Revelation 12:17, Revelation 19:10, 1 Corinthians 12, and 1 Corinthians 14, and other places. And so today, friends, today, why God is calling you today, respond to the gift of salvation today. Respond that you will follow Jesus all the way. And you not only follow Jesus, friends, but you'll take all the gifts that He's given you. You won't spurn those gifts. You won't reject those gifts. You'll accept them. And they will be a savor of life unto life to you. And God bless you to make that decision today that you need to make for Christ.